guys. Welcome to Table Talk. This is a show where Steve and I and special guest Sarah Fletcher.
Sarah Fletcher's here from the hit TV show Parker Lewis Can't Lose. What were you doing on that show? You were Parker Lewis.
You know that couch in that one scene?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That was me.
Just kidding. She was on Mr. Belvedere. What was that show like?
Mm-hmm. Do you remember that tray he used to carry?
No.
You were the tray?
For those gloves?
Oh my God!
Just kidding, guys. Sarah Fletcher is on Frankenstein MD, the Pemberley Digital PBS Digital Studios show. Mm-hmm. What is that show?
I think the title is pretty.
Is that Sarah Fletcher from 321 Contact?
Oh my God!
No, she's from Pinwheel.
I don't know why I tried to attack his finger.
Because he pointed at you.
He did.
It was rude. What's Frankenstein M.D.?
I think Frankenstein M.D. is a modern adaptation of Frankenstein. Mm-hmm. I think it's pretty self-explanatory with the title.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Frankenstein implies old. M.D. implies new. Mm-hmm. Modern.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow.
Who's in that show?
Someone's in that show.
Trisha Hirschberger?
No.
Mr. Steve.
Yes, just kidding. Yeah. Well, we've only done Iggy. A couple of scenes together.
I know.
Which makes me really sad.
And it's all the sex scenes.
It's all hardcore sex scenes. You'll see those on PBS.
There's a lot of nipple play.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's truer than you know. Actually.
You would not believe the lengths to which my scrotum will
stretch. Oh, I thought you were just saying the lengths.
Well, the lengths,
long they
are. You just brought in scrotum. We were talking about nipples.
I know, but I had to go straight for
I'm sorry, you have this piece of fuzz.
Please get rid of it, Sarah Fletcher. So Sarah plays Rory Clerval?
Clerval.
I'm sorry. Rory Clerval on the show. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And you're basically Victoria Frankenstein's best friend.
Yes, I play, so Henry Clerval was the original character, and so Rory is the, Henrietta.
There's all
there's
like,
I love gender it. Bending. I'm way into the gender bending.
Yeah, there's tons of gender bending going on for this new version of Frankenstein. In fact, the Victor Frankenstein is now Victoria Frankenstein, played by Anna Laurie, and then we've got,
Brendan Bradley. Who's playing Eli, which is Elizabeth. I'm gonna butcher this. Lavenza.
So Lavenza. You guys both did a lot of research on Mary Shelley.
No.
For this project.
No. Right. No, that's not true. I actually did go.
Brendan
did his research and like
he got Cliff's notes and shit.
Who's Brendan?
Brendan plays Eli.
Eli.
Okay.
Who originally is Elizabeth.
Okay.
And if you read the original Frankenstein, Elizabeth is Victor Frankenstein's fiance.
But also sibling. But that's not addressed.
Well, because we won't talk about that.
Because she was adopted by the family. So I read a little bit.
So you guys did some research?
I don't know how to read.
That's okay. You just listen to things on audible.com.
Go to audible.com.
So anyway, Frankenstein MD is a show that this lovely young woman is on, and that's why she's a guest on our show.
Woo!
We're
Yay!
Very pleased to have you here.
Oh my God,
you're falling
apart.
Oh,
no, I just got caught.
You guys should check it out, though, is the moral of the story, is you should go check out Frankenstein MD.
Yes, please.
Click the link in the description, yes?
Yeah, click it. There's a thing that'll pop up. Click it and then watch it.
Mm-hmm. And then actually be on for the whole show. Yeah.
But don't watch the episodes Sarah's not in, because those aren't good.
Yeah, just watch the Sarah episodes.
Sarah.
Just kidding, they're all good.
On this show, we take topics from Twitter, #TableTalk, and on reddit.com/r/sourcefed, and we talk about them. Would you like to do the honors of picking the first topic?
Reddit.com/r/sourcefed.
Can I pick it out
with my teeth?
Sure.
If you want to. I mean, I don't know what else has been in that
bowl. That is going to be gift to hell,
madam.
No. So,
should I read it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, read who it's from, and then read it out to us, and we'll answer it.
Okay. In what area of your life are you actively trying to improve?
And well, who said it?
This is going to be a tough one. HI_IM_X.
So hi, I'm X.
Oh, okay, right. That's not that hard. I was like,
is that Reddit or Twitter?
I'm X.
Oh, it's Reddit. What is it? In what area of your life are you actively trying to improve?
Actively trying to improve.
Can you think of one off the top of your head?
You know what? I need to floss more. Because I just had a bunch of cavities, and like I love my dentist. He's like the nicest guy. Mm-hmm. He's like you'd want him to be your neighbor.
Okay.
So, like, it's nice that he, like, you know, did my dental work and stuff.
So, yeah. But he says that you don't floss enough.
Well, actually, I was told that I have really acidic spit.
Oh.
Like, it just
so you're like an alien from Aliens?
Yeah, so, Sarah can kill you, is what she's saying.
If we make out, audience, anyone.
Awesome. With the entire audience.
With the entire audience. Awesome. Then you may have a hole in your
face. The kiss of death is your power.
Mm-hmm.
That's a cool X-Men power.
That's very cool. Yeah, that's very
cool. Kind of like a snake. You know, I just come in, leave my venom, and then eat you, unhinge my jaw and eat you whole.
Yeah, and you eat rats and
yeah, sometimes.
Mice.
Yeah.
Sometimes. Why not? You know?
So that's why
there's a lot of nutrients.
That's a good area to improve in. Mm-hmm.
Right,
so
like
floss
dental
more.
Care.
And dental
and shaving.
Care.
I probably should shave more, too. Oh,
yeah, that beard's really coming in right now. I don't like it.
Can you see it? I tried to get it this morning.
I can see it.
Yeah, it's real fuzzy.
You know what, though? I will say this. The older I get, and I won't say how old I am, but I have a lot more body hair, and I've always been hairy. And my mother said to me recently, "I don't know why you and your brother are so hairy." And I was like, "Thanks."
So, is your mother or father not hairy?
No, not really. No, not in particular. Like, my dad doesn't have like a super hairy chest. I mean, now he's like getting nose hair, but like that's just because he's older, and I think that's what happens. So I have that to look forward to.
I'm gonna tell you a secret from one hairy lady to another.
Let's talk about hairy ladies real quick.
Hey, we talk about Dollar Shave Club and beards all the
time.
Laser hair removal will change your life.
I bet a lot of people tell me this, and I think it needs to happen.
You need to look into it.
Well, I just feel like hair keeps appearing in places that it shouldn't be. Like, in places that I'm like, why is
like
there...
Like, where specifically?
Like...
like, on your hand?
Like,
your...
I'm gonna say, on my nipples. Ladies, if you're listening, I'm gonna put this out there, and here's why.
Wait, is this real?
Okay, put it out! Go!
Nobody told me when I was a kid...
What's happening
...that
right
women
now?
Get... Nipple hair.
I think Sarah's making an excellent first impression.
I'm not even kidding. I'm not even joking. Nobody tells you this shit when you're growing up.
So wait, when I said you had super hairy nipples earlier, we just came around full circle?
We did come around full circle.
We did. I mean, they're not super hairy. I'm not
right.
Super, super is an exaggeration.
So what you're saying is every once in a
like,
while...
Like, super would be like all of this.
around here. Where's your nipple? I'm trying to find it. Wait, so you're saying every once in a while this super thick black hair will grow out that's like it cuts through your clothing. And you can pull it through the clothes.
I mean, it's
my pubic hair is like that sometimes. It pierces denim.
Okay, well, that's
comes
pretty,
right through.
That's some pretty powerful
like
pubic hair.
Yeah. Thank you.
That means it's strong.
Yeah,
but yeah
I'm a strong man.
But Sarah speaks the truth. It's
a thing that happens, and when it happens,
in all different places.
Why don't they talk about this on The View? You think?
I don't know, because it really, probably because they, I don't know.
They can't.
They're not
they get in
why
trouble
Why don't
they
talk about
something?
It on TV at all?
I think there's a lot of stuff that you don't know.
I actually just got a little rogue, chin hair under here this morning. I was like, where's that from? That's not a thing that happened before.
Here's the other thing, too. When you get those and nobody tells you.
Oh, it's the worst.
Because then you're like, how long have, this is clearly like this long. this took how many months to grow?
And no one said anything.
Everybody was just like, oh. Cool.
I think this is definitely a generational thing, though, because if you think about, because, like, look, I'm thinking about, like, because all I'm trying to think of is, like, bringing it back to just be natural, be yourself, let the hair grow, you know, do it. But also I'm trying to think but I prefer, obviously, a less hairy woman. because I don't know, that's a cultural, societal thing.
Yeah, some people don't. Yeah. There are some
think about
cultures that definitely like their women all natural.
Yes, and like you think about like
my
the 70s Bush.
My brother likes his women, I think. Well, I don't know how he likes his women, because I don't want to think about my brother in that capacity. But you know, his last lady friend, he liked that she was au naturel. He liked the fact that she was like, no, I'm not going to confine to society.
I mean, but there's a part of me that wants to embrace that. And if it was the person I loved...
Says the man with the beard.
I know, right? I want to embrace natural flowing hair.
Yeah, I guess.
This is just laziness. This is nothing else.
You want to, but you don't
know
if you
can. All I'm saying is if I was with someone that I loved very much and they were like, you know what? I just want to go natural. I want to let it flow. Mm-hmm. Armpit hair, everything.
Everything.
I'd be like, well, I love you and that's natural, so... Why
I'm gonna
not?
Put up with it.
I'll put up with it, but hopefully it's a fucking phase, like when you were a dumb vegan for like a week. Okay. Like, but what I'm gonna say, what I'm gonna say is that this is totally a generational thing. Because I was every time I watch Game of Thrones, all I can think about is that fucking scene when Jon Snow's going down on Ygritte.
Those Merkins.
And that's all I could think of is like, man, he's going through the forest of Mirkwood in there.
And here's my question: Okay,
that's gotta be awful in there.
A man Merkin is called something else, right?
Oh, it is. I don't know. I only know
what's the Merkin? Is this just the hair around your balls and
Is that what a Merkin is?
What is it?
No, I feel like because he doesn't have these problems. Okay, right. These are problems that like women in LA have,
what the fuck
and
is
nobody
a Merkin?
Else has.
Or on stage.
Wait, is it a fake? It's like a wig for your pubic hair.
It's a pubic hair wig.
Yeah. Why?
Because
so you don't show your real vajay if you're on set, but you have to do full nudity. It's also called a privacy patch.
Yeah.
Or
if they want it to be like period authentic, because most women now don't grow a jungle to that capacity.
Right.
I don't want to say most. I don't actually know the statistics.
Should we say Americans? Maybe we could say Americans.
Yeah, I would say like you know most people I know.
Yeah.
Don't grow. So like that's like four people. You know. Mm-hmm. Don't grow. Don't
how many vaginas? Grow. Have
I actually
met?
I made Sarah a Merkin reference. To my parents over the phone like a couple months ago, and they had no idea what I was talking about. And I was like, everybody knows what a Merkin is. And then I realized, no, mostly just females in Los Angeles are aware of what a Merkin is.
Here's my question then, to you audience as well.
Ask them.
If you had to have a Merkin, okay? Like if somebody
what
was gonna-
What color would you choose?
What color would you choose?
I was just joking, I didn't know that's where you were gonna go with
and
it.
And how, and would you want it, and like, what color? And if you could have it be an odd color, like if it could be dyed,
I would go with Fozzie's skin.
Come on, purple Fozzie would be pretty awesome.
Purple.
I want Fozzie's hair. Like I want a Fozzie.
Would you be
hair
like a surprise?
So almost like this color of your burger bun.
Yes, but I want it like all
like blondie,
kinky, like Fozzie's fur.
Well, it would be. I mean, it's pubes.
Right.
Yeah, well, pubes. Fozzie's not made out of pubes. Fozzie doesn't have pubes. That's bear hair.
Okay. You ruined my whole childhood. He's kidding. About Fozzie.
Waka, waka, waka. Fozzie, you smell. Hold on a second, Fozzie. You smell like shit, bro. Well, you need to take a shower.
You smell like.
You smell like. Why do you smell like balls, Fozzie?
Oh, that's so sad.
Ah.
Oh, no.
Ah.
So sad.
Oh, my God.
Fozzie's
hair does look like pubes.
It does look like pubes.
Yeah, a little bit.
It's all right. We love Fozzie. You know what I thought, though, when I was a kid? Fozzie's hair looked like crispy KFC chicken to me.
And that. It does.
Right?
It does.
So did you kind of want to eat Fozzie the Bear?
Nah. But I felt bad when I ate KFC.
Would you want to go down on Fozzie the Bear?
Fuck yeah!
That's an easy question. Right.
I would totally give it up for Fozzie.
Okay, wait, so purple?
Yeah, purple.
You go purple? Why?
Because it's awesome.
Okay. That's fair.
I mean, it's the and same as you? Like if you have a choice between a horse and a unicorn, you go unicorn.
Right. Oh yeah, no, that's very fair. I actually think I would want to like be a surprise fire crotch for people.
Mm. Oh, that'd be great.
Like more like I would choose a color, but then I'm like, no, I just want to like fuck with somebody. Oh, yeah. Am I allowed to say?
Yeah, of course.
Oh, right. What do I say?
We've been saying pussy and balls the whole time.
And then I drop the F-bomb and I'm like, no.
Don't you say fuck on this show.
Yeah, I'd want to just like mess with someone. Yeah. Like if somebody's
with
gonna
red,
go down.
Red hair. Yeah.
Yeah. Be like,
oh, I'm sorry. But is that how real are these Merkins? They're like, what are they like?
They're real. It's real hair.
Like, how does it stay down there?
Well, they use body tape. I feel like we just blew your mind.
I don't know if I want tape that close to my junk.
Have you never had to tape? This is good. Okay. Have you never? I'm gonna ask a stupid question. Have you never had to tape underwear to yourself because you've had to do, like,
women in LA?
I can't wait to hear what you're gonna say.
Well, like. You know, there's been times where, like, you know, you'll have to be in a swimsuit or you'll have to be in, like, lingerie on a set. And then, you
as
know,
I often do.
And if you have to do, if you have to, like, move around a lot, you know, usually if you move around in underwear,
moves a little.
Yeah.
Oh, so you have to tape the underwear.
Sometimes
you either tape it or, I know for pageants, we used to use what we jokingly called ass lacquer.
What's that?
It's like roll-on glue that you put on your tush and then patch your buddy or swimsuit to your cheeks and you lacquer it to your cheeks so that when you walk in those high heels, you don't get a wedgie on stage.
Okay, no, I have a question about
this. I
don't know
how I feel about any of this, man. This is all of the, like,
butt glue does not turn you on.
I just don't know how I feel about after the pageant when you're like celebrating and you're gonna get down that you got you like slap an ass and then your hand stays on the ass and then that's it.
Oh, there's
done.
Like residual fuzz from your underwear.
Yeah,
like,
and there's like all this crud on there. Like
yeah.
Or lint? It's fun, or it's a surprise.
Did you poo yourself on the pageant, or is that lint?
I mean, I never did a pageant, but
yeah.
Oh no, you're asking a general question.
Right.
Oh, okay.
All right, what were you going to say? You were going to say something about...
I don't know.
I can't remember.
About tape, about body tape.
Oh, you were... Were you surprised that she did pageants for a second? Did you... You made like a... when
oh
she
my
said
God.
Pageants.
Oh, yeah. No, mm-hmm. I didn't realize that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Back in the day. I actually only competed
talent?
For like 3 years.
What was your talent?
I did a Romeo and Juliet monologue.
That's amazing.
In a bikini.
No, talent, you're right in that talent is more about what you wear in some competitions.
No!
Than your talent.
With women?
I know.
Right? No!
And I had this gorgeous Elizabethan gown. It was amazing.
Do you still have it?
No.
Damn it.
No.
I want to describe other things as Elizabethan. I have this Elizabethan
hamburger.
Sandwich.
You could?
Yeah. Try this Elizabethan comb.
Right. Mm-hmm. Mm, this Elizabethan ice cream is so good.
This yeah, Elizabethan tea is fantastic.
Can you hand me that Elizabethan pen? I need
it
to write
like,
a very fancy letter.
Tastes like crusty royalty.
I think we should give this Elizabethan topic launcher.
I don't know.
Try.
We didn't really talk about areas to improve.
Oh, God.
Oh, just Sarah did.
Just yeah, Sarah
what
did.
What's yours? What are you improving, Steve?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know.
You've got nothing to improve.
I like myself a lot. But I like myself quite a bit. I'm getting to know myself better the older I get, and the more I realize that I need to embrace who I am, and sometimes that means a lazy, bad person.
Well, that's a thing.
That sounds like an excuse.
Maybe I need to not eat. Maybe I need to eat better still. Like, I'm pretty good at eating a lot better, but I need to, like, keep up with the health food
stuff. Okay. Alright, that's good.
I stopped drinking diet and Coke Just Zero diet. Type stuff. Oh. Diet drinks.
Oh, I know you did that.
Yeah,
that was
done.
Good.
Never again.
I still
done.
Drink them all the
I
time.
I spoke to a man
Steve...
in an airport that scared the
yeah,
shit
Steve
out
tells
me.
Me I'm gonna die.
Yeah, you can't, man. They say the diet sodas are worse than the regular ones.
Yeah, I don't think they're... I mean, like, I think anytime, you know... I mean, look, I love some processed Cheese Whiz. So like,
Mamma mia.
Like, I'm not gonna sit here and say, like, I don't consume some of the stuff as well. I think... moderation. But yeah, I think anytime you're taking a food product and then like going several generations into byproduct of byproduct it's probably not the
best. But yeah, I mean, is it going to kill you enough that I should stop drinking Diet Coke that I love?
The worst part is, other stuff.
Like, but the worst part is no one's thinking about it. Like, people are just like putting shit in their mouths because it tastes good and they don't care.
Do you think about the radio frequencies that come out of your phone when you put it up to your
head? No, I don't. But you really should, right?
Oh, yeah. They say that too. Your phone in your pocket. Like, I did a SourceFed piece on how it makes your sperm count less.
My sperm count is way down.
I'm going to put my fucking phone next to my junk and have people call me all day.
I
think we need to circle back to what you said, which is essentially we're all going to die
work?
Of something
we're
else.
We're all going to die.
Dental
work.
Circle back to dental work.
Nipple hair.
Right, strangulation by own nipple
hair. Yeah, just I want piano cord strangulation from a nipple hair. Great.
So Sarah has to launch this.
Sarah, you have to launch this.
Oh, my thing I'm improving on, which I'm having the hardest time, guys. If you have any suggestions for this,
because you like yourself too.
No, it's not that.
You don't like yourself?
I mean, I do, but I don't like myself so much that there's nothing I think I can improve on. I'm trying to improve on, and work counterbalances this, not interrupting people in conversations. And here at SourceFed, and SourceFed Nerd specifically, you have to interrupt people to ever be heard in anything. Like when I started here, I was like, oh, I don't want to interrupt anybody. And then I'd get all these comments that were like, Trish is so quiet. Trish is so shy.
The thing is we get shit for everything.
We get shit for
interrupting and not interrupting and blinking and not blinking
and talking. Then when I'm out in real life, I find that I'm very ready to like jump the gun when I have something to say. And I'm like, oh, this is not appropriate real life.
I think that it's certain social interactions because like the group of friends that we have, we all talk over each other. And I feel like when somebody like new comes into the group, they're really intimidated because we're just doing this. Like we talk over each other. People get louder. People yell, point, push, slap.
Suck.
Know, right, suck. They start punching.
Fucking.
Just have sex.
All the time. Yeah.
No, but we do talk over each other a lot and interrupt each other, but it's not, nobody takes offense to it.
I feel like that's a thespian thing.
Maybe it is.
I don't think that sexual orientation has anything to do with it.
Yeah, maybe not.
It's Elizabethan.
I do, though. I feel like it's like an actor thing. Like, everyone's such outgoing personalities that they don't even think about it, and it just happens, and then you get used to it when you're hanging out with those friends, and then when you're hanging out with people that aren't those friends. They're not used to it.
Well, and it makes me sad when people will say, like, oh, man, that just means that you're an asshole, and you're trying to, like, interrupt people because you think you have something more important to say or something.
Sometimes I just get excited.
You're just excited!
Right.
Well, and that's why I'm, but that reason, when you say, when people say, like, it's because you think what you have to say is more important, that's the reason I'm trying to, like, improve upon it in my outside life, because I don't want people to interpret it as
you
that.
You know what, though?
Because I am just excited.
Trisha, can I tell you something? I'm sorry, my hands smell like something. Mustard because of the cheeseburger thing.
Yeah, oh, I enjoy that.
Really nice, by the way. Mm-hmm.
Can I just say something to you? Mm-hmm. I like you for who you are, and you can interrupt me any time you want.
Thank you, Steve. All right? And you can interrupt me anytime
All
right. Wait, how do I launch the topic?
Oh, yeah, okay. You gotta launch it.
So here's the launcher. You can move it higher or lower. Your goal is to hit the,
hit
lens,
the lens
of the camera.
The camera lens.
Oh, whoa. Oh, okay, maybe I should.
Just the lens.
I didn't know this was like a thing.
I think you're...
Okay.
Careful.
Oh, hold the bottom.
You gotta hold the bottom, man.
Aim it up.
Oh!
Oh, my God!
Oh, my God, that is the closest a guest has ever come.
So, if you make it,
I like
then we get to write your name down here, and you get a point.
Damn it.
Wow, that was so close.
See, you can see how hard it is by how few points are on the board.
There's literally only one point in
it.
There's three points.
Can I just lick this instead, and that'll just be my mark?
Sarah Fletcher, lick the page. All right, so McTaggart6 says, my best mate has been in a relationship for about 6 months, and he's super whipped. How do I get my best mate back? Parentheses, they met because of me. Cheers.
I mean, okay. Mm. Okay, I'm gonna take a stab at this.
Go ahead.
Okay, go for it.
I have been, I've been married for a real long time. Mm-hmm.
Preach it.
I've been married for a real long time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, girl.
Y'all.
Mm-hmm. Praise logic.
No, I think that, like, what happens is, you know, when you first start dating somebody, you're in that sort of like, oh my goodness. And then, mm-hmm. you know, what happens is you spend all this time with this person, you forget all your friends, and the next thing you go, oh shit. I still need my friends. So I think sometimes maybe just saying like, hey dude, it's not that I'd want to not, you'd not spend time with your partner, but like maybe we can all spend time together. Like maybe, you
that's
know.
That's a solution. Yes.
You know, do a lot of group hangouts where they can hang out all as a clan.
That's a great point because it says here that they've been in a relationship for 6 months. To me that still
that's
sounds
still very
like,
it's early.
It is very early.
Puppy love.
Yeah, and I feel like you as a friend probably feel very neglected and feel like you're being ignored, but the truth of the matter is just like Sarah was saying, you're very excited when you're in a new relationship and you want to be around that person all the time.
There's actually chemical, biological things going on to prove that.
Praise logic.
Now, you know that you actually can stay up later. There's certain chemical hormones that go on that make your body able to stay up later. You know, you think about like talking through the night with somebody.
Yeah.
Right.
There
right.
are actually some biological things going on. And then usually the chemical drop off happens around 9 months. Which
okay.
So there you go. Sense. I mean, it really is
so
one of those things.
So you'll get your friend back in about 3 more months.
After she gives birth to your baby.
I mean, look, wait a minute. But babies is a whole other different story because you don't want to really get into that zone. Because as soon as the baby comes but you know, as soon as the baby comes around, the friendship is over.
Unless your friend's okay with hanging out with the baby too.
Right. Yeah, maybe your friend really loves
look
babies.
Look at Owen over there.
Maybe your friend loves drinking
well,
with babies.
Well, Steve's
who
friend
doesn't love
Owen
drinking with
is
babies?
Behind the camera, and it's a great thing that they're on the same page about not hanging out
I mean,
with
but look, the fact of the matter is that I think we can all agree that it is one of those matter of time things. Give it a little time. Yeah. You know, if he's your best friend and you guys have been best friends, obviously he will not lose sight of that as long as he is truly a good friend.
I want to add to that, you got to trust your friend's opinion. I know so many people that are like, oh, I don't like who my friend's dating and I'm going to try to ruin that. Or even worse, they get to the point where it's like, oh, my friend's marrying this person I don't like and I have to say something. To some degree, it's their life.
Yes.
And even if you feel like they're whipped and they're getting taken advantage of, maybe they like it. I'm not saying they do.
We kind of looked over the whipped part.
Yeah, maybe they're like, you know what? I like being in this relationship where the other person has more power than me. Like, maybe that's where they're happy.
But also relationships.
And just because you wouldn't be happy with that doesn't mean that that's not a choice that they're making for their lives and you have to let them make that choice even if you think it's a mistake.
Yes.
It's also, oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I would say it's also sucky to me that, like, women can be whipped and it's like, oh. But men can't. That there's like this sort
of
double.
Well, it's that manly shit. It's like the whole like, oh man, you're a man, you're tough, you can't be whipped. But the thing is sometimes it just happens and
everybody wants somebody.
Everybody wants somebody in varying degrees, and sometimes it doesn't always, you know, match up the same way. And for me, it feels like it's a learned experience kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like you know, if that relationship doesn't last, then you learn like, well, maybe it was because I was too clingy and I
she had hairy nipples.
Yeah, maybe it was my hairy nipples. Maybe it was the color of my merkin, you know? And it's really,
it could have been.
It could have come down to that. But the point is that all these relationships are learning experiences. And if it seems like your friend is unhappy because he's whipped, quote unquote whipped, whatever that means
then
for you.
Then step in and say, I think you're unhappy. And,
yes, as a friend and say, it seems like you're unhappy. But
we should bone her together.
We should bone her together. Yeah.
And I'll fix everything.
Or at least send me photos of her genitals and I'll take a look and see if it's worth the whip.
When you call females nether region genitals, it just takes all the fun out of it.
It really does.
Oh, 100% yes.
Right. It's like, I don't call them, babe, do you want to look at my genitals?
Like, no.
Oh, my genitals feel so good right now.
Like, no-no zone is sexier than genitals.
No-no zone?
Yeah, is sexier than genitals. Genitals is just like.
Genitals is what I want my doctor to say.
Right.
All
right,
here we go.
Get it, Steve. Oh. That was close.
Fuck my butt.
Nope.
Do you want
not
that?
Today.
Yeah.
You do?
I need it.
Okay.
Not today. All right, Trisha, pick a top.
Okay, let's do. Zachary T. King at Zachary King 6892 says, how do you know if something you write is good enough?
Oh, you don't.
Well, we're going to judge that statement right now.
You don't is the answer. You try it.
You do. And that's the thing. I'm reading this book called How to Make Money in Hollywood or something like that. I'm sorry. I'm butchering the title, but it's from Thomas Lennon and Ben Grant, the guys from The State and Reno 911.
Oh, nice.
It's like how to
write
and make movies in Hollywood and make money in Hollywood. It's a very tongue-in-cheek kind of look at the writing process in Hollywood and kind of like the movie-making process in Hollywood. I would recommend anybody interested in writing or interested in the production process of filmmaking in any way, pick up this book because it's fantastic and these guys are hilarious.
Talk about merkins in it?
They don't talk about, you know what? I haven't finished it yet, so we'll see.
They might at some point. Write in merkins whenever possible. That's how you know if your writing's good enough.
Look, we've been writing. We write a lot. Our job requires us to write a lot. And technically, we're writers.
I mean, isn't that weird?
It's weird. We're writers.
Isn't that weird to think about?
And not every story we write is good. And not every story we write people like. Benjamin Franklin Time Traveler.
I think Benjamin Franklin Time Traveler is an amazing piece of writing. But, I think it's glorious.
Well, thank you.
I do.
You're the best.
That's not a lie. I might be BFTT's number one fan.
I mean, it's really fucking weird, but thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that.
I'm going to go watch it now.
You have to.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
We'll have a special screening where I'll dress up like Ben Franklin and I'll narrate it for you.
Great.
But in the book, they talk about how as professional writers and as people that have written many major hit movies like Night at the Museum and so many other things. They wrote Herbie Fully Loaded, I guess, but which was like garbage. They've written a lot of really bad movies, but they've also written some good movies, and they're really funny guys.
Here's my question, though. Are they bad because they've gone through, like, network notes?
Like, studios making a bajillion changes.
Yes, exactly. And that's something you learn while reading the book, too, is that the writing process in film, not so much in the book world, I think that's a lot different. But in the movie world, you write a script and then you go through your third or fourth draft or whatever, and then if the studio likes it, they buy it from you, and then you may never see that script ever again. Mm-hmm. And then if you do see it again, it might be like the 50th draft and all of your ideas are gone.
Yeah.
And you're like, oh shit, I have to try to inject myself back into this. And that's why movies like Herbie Fully Loaded, which if you read this book, you read that these guys really loved the Herbie franchise and really loved the original movies and wanted to make like a cool new Herbie that actually would have been funny and cool and fun and a big adventure movie. And when it turned out that Disney got Lindsay Lohan on board, it kind of ruined the whole thing.
It was the last movie she was legitimately cute in, though.
Right. Yeah. So anyway, good or bad, the advice they gave about writing was, if you want to be a writer, if you want to write every single day, every free moment you have. Just write. If you've got an idea in your head, sit down, just forget about watching TV, forget about going outside for a second.
Forget about having friends.
Forget about having friends or fun or eating or drinking water.
Just write.
Just sit in your room, take 2 hours, an hour and a half an hour, whatever, 15 minutes, and just write. And then eventually you'll write your first script or your first story or something, and then you'll maybe like it, maybe won't like it, maybe feel really good about it, but the fact remains is that even when you're done with that first script, you have to keep writing. Mm-hmm. Keep writing, don't stop, and then come back to that old script and then realize how bad it was, and then move forward and then learn from that bad script and then just keep going.
With that being said, I want to focus on the part of this question that says, how do you know if something you write is good enough? Mm. forget about the good enough.
Yes.
Just forget about it. Because if you don't do something or don't put something out there in any artistic pursuit, whether it's writing or making YouTube videos or making a film, whatever it is you want to do, if you're always waiting for it to be good enough, you'll never be satisfied. You'll hold yourself to such high standards that you'll never put your work out there and never do it. So forget about the good enough. Know that, like Steve said, you're going to write some brilliant things and there's going to be a lot of stuff that you write that's not brilliant to get there. That's okay. You have to do that.
Right, so. And there might be more stinkers than good ones.
I actually think I think failing too is really empowering. I mean, that sounds terrible but I think that like when you fail, you go, oh, I lived through this, like, I'm cool, I'm fine, like, this is really not that horrible if I keep, you know, flunking at whatever, you know, thing it is I'm trying to do. Because then the success is also that much sweeter, because you've got that sort of yin and the yang to it.
Right.
You know, it's like, oh,
see,
well,
all these good feels you're going to have once you get rid of good enough?
Just like the Goonies that are good enough.
Can we put, like, is there, like, a way to put, like, good enough here, and then
good
and then have your editor, like, be like, bam, and, like, put a big thing on the top of it.
Damn
oh!
it! All right.
Well, wow. Guys, thank you so much for watching this Table Talk, and super special, amazing thanks to Sarah Fletcher. Oh, we love having you here, Sarah.
Thanks,
where can they see you more if they want to?
This is so crazy. I just finished, well, I'm reoccurring on Days of Our Lives right now.
Yay!
Oh! And my episodes just aired earlier this week, which is really insane.
Fantastic.
Which is really weird.
No shit!
To do a soap.
Oh my god.
Because it's a, you know, you watch
it. Do you get, like, any sexy scenes with anyone in it? Because it's a soap.
I mean, the one guy gets, I undress him and then take inappropriate photos with him.
Oh!
Wait, is that the photo you showed me on the park bench?
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's so great.
Which is really funny.
That's so weird, man.
It's weird, and soaps are, like, really hard, and I have so much more. After doing it, I have so much more respect for soap actors. I think they don't get.
Because you get your lines, like, right before.
And then you get one take. Like, they they literally, everything you see, they do in one take, and, like, those people are pros, because they're memorizing, like, 50 pages a day. I mean, I'm like, whew.
Wow, holy shit.
Yeah. They're great.
Yay! Yeah. All right, so please check out Sarah Fletcher on Days of Our Lives and on Twitter, yes?
Yeah, I'm on Twitter.
Yeah, she is. And also on Frankenstein MD. That's
Yay!
Right. So you guys can see all that stuff in the description and click on that stuff. And we love Sarah Fletcher and we love you guys. Thanks for watching. If you want to submit topics for the bully, you can use the hashtag Table Talk on the Twitter or go to our subreddit on Reddit r/SourceFed and look for the appropriate thread there and type out some topics there. I'm Steve Zaragoza.
I'm Trisha Hershberger.
I'm Sarah Fletcher.
Yay! Oh, it's a group hug.
It's a
hug
time. I want to knock over stuff.
There we go. Oh, so nice.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
I'm gonna eat this hamburger.